Today on BRStv, we explore the next component of the BRS WWC hybrid system with excess phosphate and nitrate filtration. Implemented here on both the Red Sea XXL 750, smaller all-in-one Red Sea E-Series 170, and the BRS 160, then giving away gift certificates at the end. Hey, I'm Ryan, your host of BRStv. This week we have episode 9 of the BRS WWC hybrid system. In this series, we're developing a method of dealing with almost every major reefing topic and assembling them into one cohesive system that above all else is simple and stable. This hybrid system will also address a variety of budgets and skill levels. Almost anyone can follow and expect to achieve very similar results. Hopefully exploring these methods in a manner where, regardless of experience level in the hobby, learn something new or use WWC and BRS team's experiences to refine our knowledge. In this series, we're going to explore what we believe to be the 8 core components of a successful reefing system: filtration, lighting, flow, the cycle, chemistry, coral nutrition, husbandry, and the maintenance rhythm. In that spirit, we're continuing the conversation on filtration today, but more specifically, simple, stable filtration. Filtration consists of 4 major components: fresh and saltwater filtration, biological filtration, organic particulates and dissolved organic filtration, and then filtering out excess phosphate and nitrate. Today is all about that 4th element, excess phosphate and nitrate. That means carbon dosing, promoting the 4 stage of the nitrogen cycle: algae scrubbers, fuges, media, and biological uptake. Like most other components, this may seem simple at face value, but the more we dig in, the better the chances that we get it right, which is particularly important with the more sensitive species of coral like SPS, which also happen to have a significant investment worth protecting. The first question in all this is to answer what it is you can expect by maintaining phosphate and nitrate levels well. Not just not too high, but also not too low, because it's only worth doing if it produces legit results. Well, the first thing is maintaining them at the right level will help prevent algae growth, particularly in new tanks. The right levels will promote deeper, richer coloration in corals, as well as healthy rates of soft tissue production, and related to that, likely ability to repair damaged tissue. The right level of phosphate will also promote faster calcification, meaning coral skeletal structure will grow faster when phosphate is at the right level. Overall attention paid to nitrate and phosphate will both help eliminate or prevent pest organisms from taking over the tank, as well as help promote healthy metabolic processes such as tissue growth, tissue repair, and energy production, which will absolutely show in coral growth and coloration changes. So let's start with the stuff almost everyone agrees with. First, a source of nitrogen and phosphorus is required for every living plant or animal and is required for them to survive. That includes both the ugly algae in the tank as well as brilliant corals and fish in the tank. So why is that? Well, that's the accumulation of several college courses or even a biology degree, but at the most basic and easy to understand level, and using terms commonly used in the reefing world, I think you can think of it as a 4-stage process that might actually be helpful to think of in reverse. First, the corals or tissue production is the net result of assembling proteins. Second, right behind that, the proteins the corals use are created by assembling amino acids. And third, at the most basic level, amino acids are assembled from DNA. And lastly, fourth, DNA is made up of molecules that contain a phosphate group, a sugar group, and a nitrogen base. So walking this back in the other direction, we need a phosphate group, a sugar group, and a nitrogen base to create DNA, hence why phosphate and nitrate are important. And then we need DNA to create amino acids, and we need amino acids to create proteins, and we need proteins to make up the coral's living tissue. In a reef tank, the sugar is predominantly provided through photosynthesis, phosphate from excess food additions in the tank and resulting fish waste, the nitrogen base predominantly either from ammonia or nitrate, which is again excess food decomposing the tank and in various forms of fish waste. I think it's important to note that some of the organisms do prefer ammonia as their nitrogen source over nitrate, but many can use both. So today I want to make one important distinction. We're not going to talk a whole lot about proteins, amino acids, sugars, or other elements of coral nutrition. We're only going to be talking about filtering excess levels of nitrate and phosphate. We'll have an episode on coral nutrition in the near future. Within that, I think there's another important distinction between how the community uses the words nutrients and nutrition, because it's commonly confused. Sources of nitrate and phosphate are just a small but important component of the nutritive input for a healthy animal. For instance, you'd never think of nitrogen or phosphorus as the only required nutrients for your cat or dog or any animal you care for. In the case of corals, much of what they need they get from their symbiotic algae in the tissue and photosynthesis, but there's a more holistic and complete nutritive picture here. So in that spirit, in an attempt to evolve the conversation, I'm going to continue to refer to phosphate and nitrate as phosphate and nitrate, and not use the word nutrients. Nutrients is technically accurate, but it's also misleading because it's only a component of overall nutrition. The use of the word nutrients for nitrate and phosphate is very commonly used by the farming, hydroponic, or water pollution industry, where nitrogen and phosphorus are the primary foods for plant growth, positive for farming and hydroponics, but also negative for water pollution, where excess nitrogen and phosphorus creates undesirable algae blooms in our rivers, lakes, and water supplies. There's just been so much confusion here in the reefing industry because just like the nitrogen and phosphorus pollution of our lakes, rivers, and water supplies, which cause those algae blooms in a reef tank, excess nitrate and phosphate cause very undesirable algae or other pest growth in our tanks. This is where the race to zero nitrate and phosphate has happened within the reefing community. To be frank, 10 years ago, actually achieving a real zero of nitrate and phosphate in the tank seemed kind of unobtainable for most reefers. Most reefers were also shooting for natural levels of nitrate and phosphate, and in most of the ocean's reefs, where it's near zero, so concerns of being too low in nitrate or phosphate was kind of unthinkable. Fast forward to today, and in many cases, we've got so effective at eliminating nitrate and phosphate from the tank that it may be a limiting factor to the health of the animals in the tank. Animals mean corals, and not enough nitrogen or phosphate to create DNA, amino acids, or protein and healthy coral tissue. Okay, so all that said, to talk about filtering nitrate and phosphate from the tank and the most effective methods of approaching that, we need to decide on the universally agreed upon goal levels for both, which of course is a unicorn hunt and doesn't exist. That said, the lack of direct guidance for those looking for it isn't helpful either, so I'm going to be brave here to take all my personal experience, the entire BRS team's experience, as well as our experience talking to tens of thousands of reefers and give some direct numbers where I strongly believe reefers will have success. What I can say is universally true for sure is there isn't a one-size-fits-all answer for goal levels. There's stages of a reef tank. In the first year or two, I would simply state that the ecosystem is not stable, which allows for all kinds of undesirable organisms to take hold. It's just wise to assume that the first 2 years of a reef tank are going to take additional effort to do well, and it just gets easier from there. More or less in a newer tank, on the surface of that rock and sand, there's all-out organism warfare fighting for who's going to take over the habitat, populate, reproduce, and then defend its territory and win that microscopic battle. We obviously want to do what we can to help promote that a healthy bacterial coat, coralline algae, and coral biomass wins that battle over algae and pest organisms. At the same time, provide time to scale up cleanup crews, pods, microfauna, crabs, snails, and fish to graze on pest organisms before pest organisms can get a foothold. In the first year or two of the tank, the risk of algae or other pest organism outbreaks in the tank ranges from high to extremely likely, and maximizing success rates in those first 2 years absolutely means respecting that. So for that reason, for a tank within those first couple years, I strongly suggest a fairly low, but not zero, nitrate and phosphate level. Considering the accuracy of most test kits and methods, ideally between 0.5 and 3 parts per million nitrate and 0.03 and 0.07 phosphate. The range there on the lower range, but intentionally a bit wide, that's because chasing a specific number and trying to maintain that exactly is probably worse than just finding a range or balance that works in your specific tank. Obviously, the lower end of that range will reduce or prevent algae growth better, but you're also riding the edge of an extreme. Extreme meaning right next up to that real zero, which is really not desired in a healthy tank. Riding the edge is just more difficult to do, so if I had to give a specific number, I'd say 2 parts per million nitrate and 0.5 phosphate, but it'd be okay if you didn't get it perfectly, double so if your tank looks sharp and healthy. Only note I'd say is if you're fighting an existing issue or want to do everything you can to prevent it in the first place, understand that there might be other challenges in place of that. Low phosphate is more effective at fighting many algae than low nitrate. Phosphate is also arguably easier to control. 0.03 or lower is going to be the most effective at limiting algae growth. That said, I would say you're riding the edge of a range down there, which is much more difficult to do simply and stably, which is of course what all this series is about. Okay, so what about in a more established tank at like the 2 year mark or more? Well, these types of tanks are just not as likely to have algae or other issues because they have a solid bacterial film on the rock, solid coralline coverage. In many cases, the corals are covering a lot of the available habitat on the rock, and they often have a robust population of microfauna, crabs, snails, fish, or other elements of a cleanup crew which graze on the algae all day long. So in this case, exploring the potential benefits of higher levels, but even more likely, just reducing the amount of work required to maintain them more precisely is just okay. An established ecosystem just isn't as fragile as a new one, so maintaining perfect nitrate and phosphate levels just isn't as necessary. So in an established, healthy reef tank where you're confident that algae or similar pest organisms just aren't much of a concern, I'm going to suggest a goal level of maintaining nitrate below 25 and phosphate below 0.1. Nitrate below 25 because we know at some point nitrate transitions from a nutritive element to a pollutant, which will very likely have negative effects on coral and fish health. Not likely as extreme as immediate mortality, but I don't even want to be in the same field as that. Going higher than 25 parts per million nitrate, not always, but in many cases, also just kind of sign that the tank doesn't get a lot of attention. That may be fine now, but on a long enough timeline, that kind of mentality will very likely lead to progressively deteriorating water quality and eventually show itself in fish and coral health. So just to be clear, 25 is not the goal, but in an established 2-year-plus tank, anywhere between 0.5 and 25 will likely produce various degrees of desirable results. It's both BRS and WWC's opinion that nitrate in the tank like this isn't a goal, it's just a net result of overall nutrition input. So don't manage the nitrate, manage the overall nutrition in a manner where combined with your filtration is simple and stable and doesn't go over 25 parts per million. Okay, so what about phosphate? You will notice that the range didn't go up a whole lot and 0.1 is the max. That's because phosphate will absolutely inhibit calcification of stony corals, which to you means slower growth rates. Now, if you have a 5-year tank with abundance of coral, well, coral growth is an actual issue, you might not care, but in that 1 to 4 year range, most reefers are still looking to maximize growth and fill out the tanks. I think this part might be somewhat debatable, but Josh at WWC swears that higher phosphate levels than 0.1 also result in less desirable coloration. So in the end, if I had to pick a phosphate maximum for established reef tank, it would be 0.1, and I fully understand that some very successful reefers run some well-established tanks much higher than that. Many of these tanks are awesome, but most of them will openly say that getting maximum growth rates at this point, or even perfect coloration, isn't a primary goal. Because there's so much confusion and so many opinions on this topic coming from reefers in so many various stages of reefing, I just want to bring this home one last time. This is particularly valuable to newer reefers with newer tanks, which are the ones most often seeking this information out. More often than not, when you see someone sharing that they have 75 parts per million nitrate and 2 parts per million phosphate, and then show you their super awesome tank, that's not how the tank started. It's just where it ended up, often as a simple and stable progression to a more established tank. On the flip side of that, you'll never see a new or 6 to 12 month old tank that has 75 parts per million nitrate and 2 parts per million phosphate that looks good. It will be always, and by always I mean 99 out of 100 times, be completely overrun with algae or other pest organisms and ultimately shut down. So when all the more experienced reefers out there share desired levels of nitrate and phosphate, I hope they also share the journey and not just the destination, because that's most likely to produce the best results for the reefer asking the question. Okay, so now that we have some goal levels, what is it we know for sure? Well, related to controlling methods, I can say refugiums and algae scrubbers, which grow various types of algae to reduce nitrate and phosphate in the tank, absolutely work, particularly when there's effort put into supplying the algae with a proper amount of energy with lighting. Carbon dosing, which is the process of dosing organic carbon to the tank, which bacteria can use to reduce nitrate and phosphate, absolutely works, particularly when combined with a well-tuned skimmer. We also know that GFO media absolutely works at reducing or even nearly eliminating phosphate. We also know that chemicals like Brightwell's Phosphate E based on lanthanum chloride will effectively reduce phosphate availability in the tank. In fact, because you can dose a specific amount of Phosphate E, it might be the easiest to control and the most precise method of controlling phosphate levels in the reef tank. I think it's also pretty well documented that deep sand beds are effective nitrate reducers. There are also some longer term considerations with deep sand beds, but I do believe that they're effective solutions for nutrient control. I guess I'll also say that we know for sure watching the input of food as well as providing a stable, consistent source of food to the tank is probably the most important components to eliminating elevated nitrate and phosphate levels. Lastly, some reefers will say I have explosive algae issues but no nitrate and phosphate readings, and I can say it's almost universally true that a majority of those cases are because of a huge biomass of algae is uptaking the nitrate and phosphate before it ever have a chance to accumulate. In fact, many of those algae might even take up ammonia as their preferred source of nitrogen, and it would never even read as nitrate. In that case, it's critical that you manually remove the algae from the tank. If you scrape it off and let it die, or use a chemical and let it die, and then leave it all in the tank, the nitrogen and phosphate from the decomposing plants is just going to feed the next wave of issues. You have to manually remove it. It's also universally true that corals and coral tissue growth are a huge nitrate or nitrogen and phosphate remover. Coral biomass in the tank may even be the number one uptake of nitrate and phosphate in many well-stocked tanks. They're also likely to take up nitrogen and phosphate in a variety of forms, including captured prey type particles, dissolved proteins, amino acids, or even just as ammonia, nitrate, or phosphate. So promoting healthy coral tissue growth might be one of the most desirable and simple or stable ways of maintaining acceptable nitrate and phosphate levels in our reef tanks. One last misconception I want to clear up, and I think is near universally true, is as long as you have nitrates that are consistently detectable and maintained above 1, you likely have more nitrogen or phosphorus availability in your tanks than most of the ocean's reefs. It's commonly said that that's not the case because the ocean has an unlimited or infinite supply of nitrogen at ultra-low near zero levels, where aquariums, it's finite and there's a limited supply. Well, that's partially true. The ocean is a nearly infinite supply and the aquarium is much more of a finite supply. But as long as the level in the aquarium is above the average ocean levels and maintained at, say, 1 part per million consistently and constantly, and there's decent flow delivering it to the corals, the net availability of dissolved nitrogen and phosphorus in the aquarium will always be higher, even if there isn't an infinite supply. That, of course, doesn't touch on the fact that corals rely on other sources of nitrogen and phosphorus like captured prey and other dissolved organics in reefs, but that's something that we'll cover in the overall coral nutrition episode. Okay, so what are the elements still being debated related to nitrate and phosphate? Well, there are a lot, so I can't cover them all. First is where the level where either nitrate or phosphate in the tank would become toxic and significantly hurt metabolic health of the fish and corals. Again, not straight up mortality, but on a manner which can cause stress to their metabolic systems and make them more susceptible to longer term issues. There isn't a real answer to this yet, and I don't see one coming on the horizon, and there are just so many people out there with very high levels saying my fish and corals are fine, as there are experiencing random, unexplained deaths of what appear to be otherwise healthy fish or corals. There just isn't going to be a satisfying answer to this other than, I think, shrugging your shoulders and just assuming it doesn't matter probably won't produce the best results. And when in doubt, emulating the animal's natural habitat is one of the best starting points. So I'd just say the lower end of common ranges is probably the healthiest for many of the tank's inhabitants and just leave it at that. There are also nitrate and phosphate ratios that many people try and keep. The most common and hotly debated is the Redfield ratio. This one sparks heated controversy every time it's mentioned. This might not be perfect, but I'm just going to quote a couple lines from Wiki on this. The Redfield ratio is the atomic ratio of carbon, nitrogen, and phosphorus found in phytoplankton and throughout the deep oceans. Originally found to be 106 to 16 to 1, Alfred Redfield analyzed thousands of samples of marine biomass across all of the ocean regions. From this research, he found that globally, the elemental composition of marine organic matter, dead and living, was remarkably consistent across all of the regions. In our case, reefers don't measure organic carbon, so the important part of that ratio is the 16 to 1 nitrogen to phosphorus ratio. If you convert that to measurements that we commonly use in the aquarium, that's 10.5 to 1 nitrate to phosphate. There are a handful of reefers who feel like going way outside that ratio is what causes issues in the tank in organisms or ecosystem imbalances like dinos or cyano explosions. Well, there's evidence in the ocean that significantly elevated nitrogen or phosphorus or severely limited nitrogen or phosphorus absolutely does result in all kinds of undesirable events and explosions of certain organisms. There's nowhere near enough evidence to definitively apply that to a reef tank and expect to produce reproducible results across a wide variety of tanks, particularly when the carbon component of that equation is basically ignored. I will say that Triton is coming out with an organic carbon test, which may possibly increase all of our knowledge sets on this. Also note that the ratio does scale to some degree in various portions of the ocean's healthy reefs, where the nutrients in the ocean are higher or lower, but the levels commonly found in an aquarium are very different. For example, the results that are associated 10.5 to 1 with 0.3 nitrate to 0.03 phosphate does not necessarily scale to any value, like 21 parts per million nitrate and 2 parts per million phosphate. In fact, my assumption is it doesn't, especially if you have no clue what the carbon level is. So is there any value in the Redfield ratio? Should it be discussed, explored, or just thrown in the trash as absolutely no value? Well, I don't think there's a lot of value for the average reefer because it's more likely to cause them to chase numbers and create an unstable tank than anything. However, behind the scenes, there are some pretty intelligent reefers out there exploring the effects of imbalances, limited availability, and elevated levels of carbon, nitrate, and phosphate in the reef tank on both corals and pest organisms like dinos and cyano. My suspicion is the net result of those efforts and conversation won't produce a scalable ratio, but I wouldn't be surprised if it eventually nets legit information for avoiding or solving common issues with corals or pest organisms. But as long as it's done with the understanding that this is being done in the spirit of exploration rather than direct advice, I think exploration or hobby should always be encouraged. In the end, I think the Redfield ratio is pretty far from transitioning from a hotly debated topic to something that most reefers would widely recommend. I would be pretty shocked if the net result of all that is we all end up running at 10.5 to 1 nitrate to phosphate and number chasing, but I think we may find that 500 to 1 produces replicable, undesirable results, particularly in new tanks or ecosystems which are the most susceptible to issues. Somewhat related to that, I think it's also debatable how effective maintaining low nitrate or phosphate is at preventing or treating pests like dinos or cyano. In past, elevated nitrate and phosphate levels were treated as a direct cause of both of those pests, and somehow you're just a bad reefer or you take care of your tank poorly if you run into them. I just don't think that's the case. It may be that elevated nitrate and phosphate levels play a role here, but I would say it's hard to believe that elevated levels alone are the direct cause because I very rarely see reducing nitrate and phosphate alone as an effective solution for fighting or permanently solving it, particularly on newer tanks in that first 2 years. I just believe many of these pests are part of that microscopic war for territory and nutritive elements. Different scenarios and sometimes random events cause different organisms to win that war. For cyano, many reefers may have better luck fighting cyano with competing bacteria with solutions like Dr. Tim's Waste Away or similar solutions, as well as those from Brightwell like Microbacter Clean. I think part of the reason why these solutions are not more popular is the EPA heavily regulates pesticides, so they're not really able to say kills or controls cyano or dinos in the packaging, meaning that only the most researched reefers will even try something like this. In that spirit, I think it's debatable as to how or if these products are effective solutions, and they're generally not sold as such, but if direct nutrient control isn't working, I'd start to look to the community in alternative solutions which may be helpful. Dr. Tim does have a quick use guide on their resources page of their website. Moving on, I think many reefers are consistently debating if an algae scrubber, Fuge, or algae reactor is the best option for nitrate or phosphate control or reduction. I just say they all work. It's just a question of space, complexity, and maintenance. My personal preference is a Fuge if you have the space because it's just a box of water with a light and the most simple and stable. The algae reactor is cool, double so if you're a gearhead or limited on space, but it does need to be periodically disassembled to remove the algae, which is a pain. Algae scrubbers are also super effective, the most compact option, also a cool piece of gear, but require you to scrape them clean fairly frequently and require you to watch them closer and monitor performance. So net result is they all work, just different space and maintenance requirements. The best method of carbon dosing is also hotly debated. Tons of DIY methods out there with vodka or vinegar, as well as commercial products like Red Sea's NO3, PO4X, as well as biopellets. All of them work. I'll just say that biopellets are my least favorite because while it might be easier, it just doesn't seem as controlled. My preference is a dosing pump and a controlled carbon dose. As a DIY or NO3 PO4X, there just isn't a wrong answer, but I do think that newer to intermediate reefers will likely have more success with the dosage guidance and concentrations that come with the product designed to be used for this purpose. There's some legit value in direct guidance on how to use something properly that doesn't come with DIY solutions. DIY is obviously the lowest cost and a really high value solution for someone that's willing to do the research on the right mix and dosages. One of the other things debatable about carbon dosing is we all know what happens when you underdose. It just doesn't remove all the nitrate and phosphate. However, what happens when you overdose organic carbon like vinegar or vodka to the tank? It just isn't as clear. Presumably, it just builds up over time and hopefully managed with water changes. I know the organic carbon in the tank and what happens when it's severely elevated or depleted, as well as in relation to phosphorus or nitrogen, is something some of the more advanced reefers are certainly exploring. So it's worth thinking about what happens in an overdose. I also think the proper use of GFO is debatable. GFO is one of the most effective tools for eliminating phosphate from a tank. It will work, but in some cases maybe too well. I mean, it's super effective at maintaining low phosphate and a huge preventative solution to stopping algae outbreaks before they happen. However, it can also give a very false sense of water quality, and nitrates are often off the charts. Finance is going to kill me for saying this because we sell a ton of GFO, but it just isn't my favorite solution to run 24/7 because it only addresses phosphate and not nitrate. I'd rather use a solution that addresses both and then use GFO as a more periodic tool when phosphates have independently risen past desired levels, essentially a tool or solution rather than a primary filter. That said, GFO can be a huge part of getting newer, less experienced reefers past the most difficult stages of a new tank. The one last debatable I want to cover is how much that last stage of the nitrogen cycle is happening in the rock where the nitrate is being converted into nitrogen gas and bubbles out of the tank. This concept gets thrown around a lot and debated endlessly. I'll just say, due to the sheer amount of people who have a ton of rock in their tanks but really, really high nitrate, I just don't think this is happening to a degree that it matters or can be relied upon. It's just not super valuable to be considered as a major component of nitrate control. It's 100% opinion and just interpreting my own experiences and those I talk to, and there are tons of good reason to have a lot of rock, but this is just not one I personally factor in. I totally understand if others feel differently, and I do think it's much more likely happening in sand, particularly deep sand. Okay, so what's the WWC approach to nitrate and phosphate filtration? Well, number one is the sheer amount of coral biomass and related nitrogen and phosphate uptake all these corals have. This amount of biomass is really just a nitrate and phosphate sponge. Combined with that, the 500, 900, and 293 are all well-established tanks with excellent maintenance and waste export solutions with a 10 to 15% weekly water changes, skimmers and filter socks or pad changeouts. They really just don't need to address excess nitrate. As long as it's under 20 to 25, they just really don't care. If it goes above that, they address it with water changes or adjust food input. However, with phosphate, their goal is to not go above 0.1 for growth and coloration reasons, and left to their own devices, the phosphate levels will rise above that. So they use Brightwell Phosphate E. The nice thing about Phosphate E is it's a controlled dose, so it'll precipitate out a controlled amount of phosphate, which means with some trial and error, you can make specific changes to phosphate levels in your tank. A dose of X will have Y result, and it should be similar each time, which is pretty valuable. Reefers ask all the time what happens to the phosphate when the lanthanum chloride or phosphate E precipitates out, and it may be removed by the skimmer or filter sock pad, but it may just also settle out somewhere, and it shouldn't ever be released again unless the pH were to fall very dramatically, like a couple to a few points in the tank, in which case you got much bigger issues to deal with. So where has the BRS team seen the most success? Well, our vantage point is just much different because we have so many newer to intermediate reefers in the first couple years of their tanks looking to us for advice and solutions that will produce results for them, particularly to get past the most difficult couple years. So our vantage point has always been to maintain lower phosphate and nitrate levels. The BRS 160 has been near undetectable for many years. We manage nitrogen and phosphate availability for the corals largely through large amounts of daily food addition. Well, most of us have tried various forms of carbon dosing to achieve those very low levels. Very few of us have stuck with it, other than the Zeovit tanks where the carbon dosing is part of the entire process and controlled. I think Jason's tank is a fine example of how the Zeovit approach worked out for him. So well that he tried a few methods other than that, now going back to Zeovit with his new tank after he moved to the new station in the warehouse. By far the most popular option for nutrient control here at BRS is refugiums and scrubbers. For anyone who has a space, the refugium being the easiest to manage solution for tanks like the BRS 160. In the end, for me, the Kato-based refugium just be the simplest and stablest way to maintain low nitrate and phosphate. Only effort required is walk by, grab a handful once a month or so, and throw it in the trash, and it just works. The only issue is sometimes it might work too well and you should just adjust a photo period or food input to match the tank's needs. However, many reefers here have smaller tanks like these 60 cubes Vertex gave them a while back, so in cases like this, a scrubber is a more realistic option based on space alone. I think Zach's tank, which doesn't have a skimmer and relies solely on water changes and the scrubber to maintain nitrate and phosphate, is probably the best example of success. Looking at this tank, everyone would call this a very successful approach. Because we get this question asked a lot, I did ask why WWC doesn't run fuges as part of their method, and this is what they had to say. I think it's just best shared word for word from Josh's mouth. I don't think there is too much to discuss here, just because it's almost exclusively one reason to have a refugium. That's the exported nitrates and low levels of phosphate. We primarily keep bare bottom tanks, so really the only pollution we deal with is phosphate. This is easily controlled by water changes in phosphate E without using a device to accomplish that same result. In our tanks with sand, do you think that that could be beneficial? Probably, but again, just another implementation, whereas we already manage pollution in our own ways. I feel refugium could be a great addition when the same lower levels we're looking to achieve cannot be accomplished or seem out of reach. This would be especially true for older tanks with tight rock structure, poor water movement, and an old sand bed. Some scenarios are a perfect fit for a refugium, tanks that have a giant fish load and a large production of nitrogen, or even beginners with an immature reef that overfeed and the tank can't process all of the ammonia. This is a great tool to lean on. However, if underfed, this can be a reason for corals to shrink, slim down, lose color, or just altogether let go. This can be the same result in a bare bottom tank without the input of nutrition. The tank can become visibly deficient. Now add a refugium to a bare bottom tank and its export, we'd be exceeding its intake, making it difficult to achieve the best coloration. So there you have it, and I think Josh's direct words matches almost everything that we've been talking about today, and I hope that it adds some clarity. Okay, so what is the BRS WWC hybrid for excess phosphate and nitrate? Well, just as a reminder, to meet WWC requirements, it needs to be simple and stable at all costs. Simple meaning two things. You don't have to be an electrical engineer or marine biologist to produce results and no unnecessary equipment or complexities. Stable meaning three things. Equipment is chosen based on reliability over features, relies on time-tested proven methods, elimination of failure points, and over-reliance on technology. In addition to that, to meet BRS requirements, the method needs to be applicable to a home or office environment, meaning it respects that reefers work, sleep, and travel, and so we're frequently away from the tank. In a home environment, it also needs to be reasonably quiet. The system has to have a reasonable amount of maintenance for a home environment, meaning an understanding there isn't a team of trained professionals taking care of the tanks on a daily basis. We're also going to fulfill the commitment to building a hybrid system that will address a variety of budgets and skill levels almost anyone can follow and expect to achieve very similar results. In that spirit, we're going to attempt to offer three options in each case, an option where low cost is a priority, common option where that's often that balance of cost and features, and a high-end option which often costs double or triple but comes with legit advantages for those that value or require them. Okay, well, this is going to be unremarkably simple. The BRS WWC hybrid solution for filtering excess nitrate and phosphate is don't let the nitrate and phosphate build up to begin with. I mean, maintain the skimmer and filter socks or pad properly and perform your 10 to 15% weekly water changes and match your food intake to that. If your levels are rising, just stop feeding so much. It is that easy. You just don't need to test all that often either. Every few weeks or month is probably adequate. We're not chasing numbers here, just trying to not stray too far away from the goal. Then recognize the goal is likely a moving target. While 25 parts per million might be okay in an established tank, the goal is likely much lower in a new or less established tank because the goal there is often to get through the ugly phase of a new tank with as few challenges as possible. Only thing I'll throw in here is a properly set up refugium is super simple and stable and what I call an optional component of the hybrid system. Optional meaning recognition that the tank requires a reasonable amount of time and maintenance for a home environment, and there isn't a team of trained professionals taking care of the tanks on a daily basis. A few just reduces demands on getting testing and feeding perfected in perfect balance with the tank, particularly on a newer tank. I would, however, get the tank up and running first, then see how it goes, then use a fuge as a tool to solve an issue rather than run it from day one. Then as part of the hybrid system, I tend to agree in theory that the phosphate E or lanthanum chloride is the simplest and because of that, potentially the stablest approach to maintaining phosphate. I haven't used it myself, but I'm going to trust in WWC here and give it a go. It's at the cost ranges of implementation here, I think the only component that really relates to is the optional fuge and lighting solution. The low cost option probably being the 2-lamp Sunblaze T5 solution which comes with grow lamps. At its current price of $93 shipped, I don't think you can find better. That balance of cost and features being the spectrum and intensity tunable H160 Tuna Flora LED LG Grow Light from Kessel. This is probably bright enough for most people's applications, more compact than a large T5 fixture and also adjustable. I'm pretty certain that most reefers will find ample growth from this light to match a reasonable size tank up to say 120 gallons. Then the high-end option, which costs a lot more but comes with legit advantages, being a tie for me. I would choose the H380 Kessel Grow Lamp. The Fuge is not under the stand. It's been the best option that I've used with the spectrum optimized for plant growth, but with limited space on the tank, it can be hard to get it high enough over the Fuge and can be too bright. There's just no option to tune the intensity down, which makes it hard to implement. I have been told that they're going to make an adjustable version sometime in the next year, but who knows. However, if you have a remote sump, the H380 is an awesome solution. So what if your Fuge is underneath the tank? Well, in that case, I think the Radeon G4 XR15 Pro freshwater light is probably the best option in our industry for a common size Fuge. The HI optics spread light well, the flat form factor allows for mounting it higher over the Fuge in a closed environment, and more importantly, you can adjust the light output and even acclimate your Kato to the XR15's higher output. Even though the H380 might be a bit more optimized for plant growth, I think many reefers might end up being the happiest with the freshwater version of the XR15. Okay, so what does this implementation look like on the three different tanks? Well, on the XXL750, we have that solid skimmer implementation, roller mat, and I can tell you right now, this tank is gonna have automated water changes on it. So I'm gonna follow the WWC approach and just match our feeding to that. If for any reason I have challenges with that, there is a Fuge solution in these larger Red Sea sumps, and I'll add a Kato-based Fuge as simple, stable solution if there's an identified issue. If it is needed, the solution would likely be two H160 tuna flora Kessels just because of the rectangular area of the Fuge. We'll also use the Phosphate E as the phosphate solution as needed. Now in a smaller, more affordable tank, there's no way around it. On a small tank where affordability is often a major factor, the best way to manage excess nitrate and phosphates is just not to add them to begin with, meaning careful food input to match your export. This also happens to be the simplest and stablest approach. The one thing on a small tank like this is water changes are small and easy to do, and so you can adapt that easily as well. For some reason, if you just can't end up managing food input with an all-in-one tank like this, I just can't say enough how convenient it is that A160 has those convertible ports already installed for a sump if you want. Just throw a small glass tank down there and you'll have solid Fuge options as well. Lastly, in the BRS160, the only real issue here is we can't maintain phosphate and nitrate levels over zero in this tank, so we're going to up the feeding schedule even more to compensate, something that we'll cover in that coral nutrition episode, and we're going to leave the Fuge alone. Not only because it works awesome, but also because removing it would be a really huge destabilizing event, something that we'd be willing to do at some point, but just not at the same time as we remove the sand. I just don't think that would be smart. So one of the beauties here is both these tanks will have a large protein input, but you'll get to see the difference between the BRS160, which will likely always have a low nitrate and phosphate, and the XXL750, which over the years will likely let it drift up to a stable 10 to 25 parts per million nitrate like the WWC tanks. Again, both will have very heavy protein input, but it'll be interesting to see if the higher nitrate makes a difference one way or another beyond that. So today we got some distinct goals and really nailed it on the different goals for different stages of the tank. I certainly hope that was helpful. Next week is something that I think a lot of you might find even more interesting, flow. WWC thinks that flow is more important than lighting, and we're going to explore why. So if you have any questions that goes beyond what we talked about today, look out for when I go live each week and answer real time with a bit more in-depth thoughts. To be notified when we do them, you have to hit both that subscribe button as well as the notification bell right next to it, which will let you know the moment we start. Outside of that, we welcome your questions in the Facebook group, #AskBRStv, where not only Randy, the team, and myself answer your questions, but the BRS community really engages with each other with like-minded and friendly folks. And over on Reef to Reef, this week's poll is, what level nitrate do you maintain? And I think we all want to see what the most engaged community is doing collectively. Lastly, no week is complete without giving away something for free. So we're giving away free gift certificates again for Black Friday. The best deals of the year are right around the corner. So click that link in the lower left or head on over to the site and click on free prizes to sign up. See you next week with another episode of BRStv where we focus on flow.